Our theme for the Benedictine Conversations series this year is the connection between beauty and justice. And so I'm really happy to welcome Gary here to help us explore this theme more fully. I mentioned a second ago his first children's book. And I would like to begin our evening together with a beautiful video that has been made of this book of his, which we're going to use this video for our opening meditation. So I invite you all just to sit back and to let yourself be swept into the beauty of this lovely story entitled A Common Thirst.
A Common Thirst, written by Gary Boelhower, illustrated by Sarah Brocky. Not far from here, the land was divided into towering mountains and level plains. Sure-footed goats ruled the mountains, where snowfall melted into streams that rushed down the slopes, giving the goats all the water they needed. The plains were ruled by gentle sheep. They were never thirsty because rain fell on the plains, making meandering creeks. But one year, no snow fell, and not a single rain cloud filled the sky. The stream beds turned bone dry. No green shoots or grasses grew. The thirsty, hungry goats gathered around their wise king, who listened to their grumblings. Surely, he thought, I can convince the sheep on the plains below to share their water and food. The sheep were thirsty and hungry too, because the meandering creeks also had become dry as dust. The weary sheep gathered around their wise queen, who listened to their grumblings. Surely, she thought, I can convince the goats in the mountains to share their water and food. As the goats journeyed, they saw the sheep plodding across the plains toward them. As the sheep journeyed, they saw the goats climbing down the mountains toward them. The sheep and the goats met in the foothills, an unfamiliar place, neither mountain nor plain. When the king of the goats and the queen of the sheep approached each other, their scrawny bodies, dusty coats, sad eyes, made clear neither had water or food. A full moon cast an eerie light over the barren land. Feeling fear and mistrust, the sheep and the goats made separate camps. The sheep have nothing to offer us, the king said. Let's create a safe circle and rest. We will decide what to do in the morning. The goats are just as hungry and thirsty as we are, said the queen. Let's flock close together and rest. Tomorrow, we will decide what to do. But the young sheep and the young goats could not sleep in the bright moonlight. Fascinated with the foothills, the kids and the lambs were eager to explore. As they wandered, the lambs and the kids came face to face. At first, they were afraid, but then they started to speak. The youngest lamb asked, "How do you climb on the slippery rocks so high in the mountains?" And the youngest kid asked, "Doesn't your wool get heavy in the rain?" The lambs and the kids talked and wandered late into the night until they found a cave where they could rest. Inside, the moonlight shone through a crack. As the youngest kid walked toward the light, he heard a faint gurgling, bubbling sound. Suddenly, his hoof slipped into a crevice and made a most wonderful splash. "Water!" the lambs and the kids shouted. The older goats and sheep came running and quickly separated the young ones. "This is our water," bellowed the king of the goats. "It gurgles at the foot of the mountains, and we rule the mountains." "No," insisted the queen of the sheep. "This is our water. It bubbles at the edge of the plains and belongs to the creatures of the plains." The king and the queen argued for hours as the sun rose in the sky. Suddenly, the youngest kid collapsed. The king of the goats declared, "We will protect our youngest kid so he can drink." In a weak but clear voice, the youngest kid said, "I won't drink this water unless it is shared by us all. We all have stories and dreams and thirst." The king and the queen knew in their hearts the young goat spoke the truth. They guided the kids and lambs to drink the gurgling, bubbling water together. For as long as the drought lasted, the goats and the sheep met in the foothill cave to quench their common thirst. At last, after several long dry weeks, clouds gathered over the mountains and rain fell on the high ridges. Water ran down the mountains and into the valley, bringing life to the slopes and plains again. As the sheep and goats prepared to journey homeward, they agreed to gather in the foothills every year to always remember their common thirst, their common life. Common Thirst, written by Gary Boelhower, illustrated by Sarah Brown.
What a beautiful, beautiful, beautiful story, beautiful illustrations by Sarah, and what a just a lovely video of a book. I've never seen a video put together like that from a children's book. That was just every time I listen to it, Gary, it just gets me right here in my heart. Could you tell us a little bit of background information on this book? What prompted you to write a children's book after all this adult writing you'd been doing, and what gave you the inspiration?
Sure. Well, I wrote this story originally when my kids were small. They were little. They were the age when they wanted a story or two every single night. And I've written quite a number of children's stories. This is the first one published with all the pictures. So it was really my desire to help them understand the common good, the common life that we all share. And this is a, you know, I've been teaching theology and ethics, morality all of my career. And I was already teaching for several years before the kids came along. And at the very core of ethics and morality is this central theme of the common good, that when we're making ethical decisions, moral decisions, we ask not just what's good for me, what's good for my family, what's good for my group, you know, but we ask what's good for us, mm-hmm. what's good for all of us.
Right.
And of course, you know, we teach this all the time to our kids when we ask them to share their toys in the sandbox, or when we, you know, perhaps take them along when we're helping to serve people at a meal program or something. And I wanted to continue to nurture this experience of the common good, mm-hmm. that this is something so important for the individual and the whole community, mm-hmm. and so that's ultimately the inspiration for the book.
So what you just said a second ago, to nurture that experience of the common good, the common life. I mean, we can talk about it when we're out here, but to have that experience, you know, when the one, I can't remember if it's a goat kid or a lamb who says, it's kind of like the climax of the book, I think, where he says, I won't drink this water unless it is for us all, because we're all thirsty. That's that experience you're talking about. Yeah,
exactly. And that, of course, the insight comes from earlier when they're full of questions, they're full of exploration, as the young often are, right? And they go out into the moonlight to explore this new land, and they come face to face. And of course, at first, as they've been taught, they're afraid, they're uncomfortable. There's difference here. There's something to fear. And yet, beyond their fear, what overtakes their fear is this common inquiry, this common desire to know more about the other. And so they begin the conversation, as we're having a conversation this evening, right? They begin the conversation with authentic, sincere, genuine questions. How do you do this? Who are you? Where do you come from? What's your story? And they come to the realization that they have more in common than they have differences. They come to appreciate each other, to want to know more about each other. They come to see something of the preciousness of each other's story. And it is out of that experience of each other's story that the youngest kid says, I won't drink this water until we all drink it, because we all have stories. We all have dreams. We're all thirsty.
Right, right. You know, you place the wisdom in that story in the hearts and minds of the youngest. Tell us about that.
Well, yeah. You know, Saint Benedict in the rule says, whenever you're making a decision, you should listen to everybody. The abbot should listen to everybody, and the prioress should listen to everybody. But they should take special note of the response of the young.
Hmm.
Why? Because the young often come at things with fresh eyes, with fresh ideas, with less of the burden of assumptions. As we grow, we experience failures, and we experience how long it takes for things to change sometimes, and we experience our own limitations and our own weaknesses. And there's a sense in which young people haven't had that much experience of those things yet. Mm-hmm. And so they're a little bit more apt to come at things with fresh eyes. Mm. Yeah.
Without the walls that we can put up as we go through those experiences you're talking about. Yeah. Yeah, out of the mouths of babes, huh?
Right.
So in the story, you very clearly draw a link between the beauty of the resolution between the two groups, the harmony and peace that comes from that. That's why it's such a meditative kind of prayer for me, and the justice of the common good. All were thirsty, all were taken care of. So could you share some of your own thoughts with us on the connection between beauty and justice?
Yeah. This is really the core of the conversation, I think, for the entire year, right? To explore this connection between beauty and justice. And it seems to me that when we experience awe, wonder, the preciousness of another, the beauty, the preciousness of a landscape, of a particular place, that we love, then the claim of justice can be heard.
Hmm.
Right? Because we experience value. We experience the value of the other person. We experience the value of the environment. Daniel McGuire, a moral theologian, says that everyone has a foundational human moral experience, and that is the experience of the value of persons and their environment. That everybody has that experience to some degree. We might experience it, for instance, when we first realize that our parents still love us, even when we're naughty, right? Mm-hmm. Or we might experience that preciousness of persons, that amazing uniqueness of persons when we experience the death of a grandparent or someone we love. And we realize that there is simply no way to replace that life. That every life is unique, is irreplaceable.
Mm.
We might have that experience, as I've had three times, of holding a brand new baby, just moments old, in our arms, and we're speechless.
Mm.
Absolutely speechless, because nothing, no word can touch the awesomeness, the beauty, the tremendousness of this life that is gift. So, however we experience that foundational moral experience, it's the experience of the ultimate value, the preciousness of other persons and the preciousness of, various places on the earth, right? Mm-hmm. And when we have that experience of preciousness, that experience of ultimate value, then we are called, we are claimed by justice, right? To respect that person, to honor that person, to do, to decide, to make the moral decision have our actions coincide with the preciousness of persons and the beauty of the earth. So I think that justice begins in this experience, in this posture of wonder, of awe, of appreciation, when we see the beauty in another, the beauty in our land. So, I mean, in order to be a more just society, we need to learn to love more fully, right? We need to listen to each other's stories, just as what happens to the sheep and the goats in the book. When we listen to each other's stories, we begin to recognize again the preciousness of that life, the beauty of the struggle, of the journey in that person's life. Mm-hmm. And we're claimed, right, to then respect and honor and act in a way that befits that value.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, claimed. You're talking about it kind of just happening to us. It's not like an intellectual decision we're making. It's something that comes out of that experience of love. So would you say that love comes from the experience of wonder and awe?
Yeah, I think so. I think it does. It comes out of that, there's a sense of amazement, a sense of deep gratitude, even a sense of mystery about, the beauty of another person and the beauty of the environment.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the source for this claim of justice. Later on, of course, we're going to make calculations. We're going to make rational arguments. We're going to do that in theology and philosophy and ethics. But it begins in the heart, right? In the affections, in the exchange of story, in the gaze into another's eyes, into the gaze at the beautiful fall foliage around here in Minnesota, the immense beauty of a lake. It's that experience that is behind our realization that we have to act in a certain way that respects the person, respects the earth. In fact, this word respect comes from the Latin speciere, which means to see, right? Mm-hmm. We have to really see. So once I really see you, then I'm called to act in a way that does justice in your life. Mm-hmm. Once I really see the earth, the beauty, the preciousness, the value of the earth, of the environment, then I'm called, I'm claimed to act justly in terms of the environment.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I'm hearing you say, and it's making me think about our speaker in September, where he talked about beauty unselfs us. And I'm hearing you say that when we encounter beauty, when we are in this posture of wonder, of awe, that we're pulled out of ourselves, out of our own little box that we create for ourselves, into the other.
Right. Yeah, and we recognize that other, right, as precious.
Yeah, yeah, that's a great word, precious. Could you just tell us a little bit about how you were led to this kind of work? Gary, your writing, your poetry, teaching, theology, justice work. Where did this all begin?
Yeah. Well, I think it began with my mom. She loved everyone. And I can say that just clearly. There was never an instance in my experience where she didn't love openly and radically and unconditionally. Mm. And early on, she took me along with her to what we then called the old folks' home. And we would go there a couple of times a week and visit with people and set up the place for worship and wheel people around from their rooms and sing with them. And almost every Sunday, we had one of the folks from that home with us at the dinner table. So early on in my life, there was this very simple realization, I guess, that everybody is important, that every life is precious, and it doesn't matter what age you are, and it doesn't matter if you can speak well or not, it doesn't matter if you can walk or if you're in a wheelchair, and it doesn't matter, nothing can get in the way of this personness, of this absolute value and preciousness that every person has.
Hmm.
And her, her attitude about people was also kind of similar to her attitude about everything. Let me read you a poem that is pertinent to this season of October.
Please.
That gives you a little sense of mom's perspective.
Yes, yes.
This is called Apple Pilgrimage. Right, so often you find my poetry has the resonance of ritual and religious connotation.
Mm-hmm.
A chorus line of geese honking hosannas pulls us toward the orchard, annual pilgrimage in orange October. The breeze clatters through the corn stalks and coaxes leaves into wild kite stunts, flashing colors rise and dive. Glow of goldfish fin, dance of flame, finch feather shine, the colors swoop and sail until they are gathered into the lap of the storytelling mother who knows the rhythm and rhyme of all time. In the back room of the apple orchard store, far from the bales of straw perfectly arranged to look haphazard for the customer's critical eye, the apples tumble down the conveyor belt unsorted, small, large, misshapen, some with blemishes from summer hail or scars where birds stole a sweet morsel against the hungry day. Some are crushed for cider, others sold for cheap seconds, and some in fine baskets labeled choice. Mm. We never bought from the orchard store. Mom and I picked the apples off the ground. We wore clothes left over from the church rummage sale, and the orchard owner gave us windfalls for free. Some were nearly perfect, and in my memory, all of them were sweet. The ritual was exact. The apple was rubbed to gleaming green and red, then snap of teeth entering, earth taste of skin, explosion of juice. Some apples were nearly lost, violence of storm, rotting in the moist grass, but we piled them all in our hungry basket. And later, pleading for pie, I watched her fingers, twisted with rheumatism, cut out the bruised flesh with the skill of a surgeon, just down to the white sweet, peeling only the thinnest membrane, not to waste a single slice. Each apple was a gift to her, nested in her lap, then turned in her hand with such close attention. It must have been prayer. So that's kind of the way she did things. Wow. The way she appreciated everything. The way she had questions of others and listened to their stories. The way she went out of her way to ensure that others felt welcome and fed. So I caught that with some of that, and try to live and live out some of that same spirit and value.
Yeah, she taught you wonder and value, and justice rolled from it. Yes. Yeah. Wow. What about poetry? Tell us about your poetry beginnings.
Oh my, yeah. So I like to say that poetry saved my life because in kindergarten, I didn't like my teacher. And actually one day I scratched her and ran home. And in first grade, these were the days when first graders were still getting report cards with grades on them. And I got D's and F's in first grade. And my teacher wrote on my report card in the comments section, "Does not play well with others." It was basically we were going downhill fast. And then in second grade, I had this amazing little spirit-filled nun by the name of Sister Michaela. And we were preparing for some kind of special activity day or something. And she took me aside and she said, "You know, you could read a poem or recite a poem for the class." I don't know what exactly she saw in me or what, but I wrote, I read a poem in front of my second grade class. And later I started reciting poems for the fifth graders and the seventh graders and the eighth graders. Here's actually the poem about the poem.
Okay.
I failed first grade. The teacher wrote on my report card, "Doesn't play well with others." But then in second grade, I had a chance to recite a poem. I chose a poem my father loved, that he would recite from time to time, usually when he was drunk, usually late at night, slumped on the couch, a beer bottle firmly clutched in his hand. What a poem that became a song that reeled out of him like fish line being pulled by some insistent, invisible life below the surface of things. On those nights, I heard something more than the usual arguments and fights, a deeper rhythm that lived in him, greater than his disappointments, greater than second shift at the paper mill. I recited that poem in front of my second grade class, and they clapped. I almost sang that poem, like my father did. The teacher asked me to recite it the next day for the third and fourth graders, too. So yeah, I guess I got into the word business because the story was so important. Every story connected me to somebody else's life, just, you know, to some other experience. Mm-hmm. And as I looked at the world, I wanted to be a person who connected people to those experiences of preciousness and wonder, to those experiences, you know, some of them hard, some of them lovely, but some of them difficult. Mm-hmm. But to use words to tell the story that we can then be connected more fully, more closely to each other. And again, in that connection. So to me, this is all together. In that connection comes the claim of justice. Mm-hmm. That's why equity and equality and the right decision is so important for the common good, mm-hmm. because we are inexplicably connected, mm-hmm. always, mm-hmm. even when we think we're alone. We're, of course, interdependent, mm-hmm. connected. Yeah, so
wow.
You saved my life.
All right, we're glad that poetry saved your life. I have a question from Barry. He writes in, Gary, you indicate that we feel justice in the one-to-one connection, but isn't justice a collective decision towards society?
Certainly, justice is the claim for the common good, right? But I think, again, our commitment to justice, our commitment to the common good, only comes because we have some kind of personal experience of the stories of others. Mm. We have some kind of sense of community, some sense of the value of others. This is why McGuire says, at the ground of ethics, at the ground of morality, at the ground of justice, is this experience of the value of persons and the value of the environment. There's no way that we can push justice on someone unless they have this kind of experience. Now, clearly, we can nurture that experience. We can help others. We can help our students. We can help our family members. We can help kids to have experiences of connection, experiences of awe, of wonder, of the preciousness of others. And in fact, it's critical that we provide and nurture those kinds of experiences. I mentioned before, right, how my mom, you know, took me with her to the old folks home.
Right.
I took my kids to the meal program and, mm-hmm. and to marches and rallies and all sorts of things. And actually, anytime we move beyond our comfort zone, right? We're intentionally allowing, facilitating another connection, right? A connection to another that again creates the foundation for doing justice, mm-hmm. for making moral decisions that recognize the value of others and the environment. Yes, justice is absolutely something that entails all of us, that entails the common good, but it is grounded in the experience of the value of persons.
That makes sense. Yeah. Paulette wrote in and she's saying what's going on in my head right now. Where then is justice if the individual does not have these experiences, if the individual does not experience wonder, connectedness, moving instead to self or tribalism?
Yeah, it's very difficult. It's very difficult to nurture the common good, to nurture policies and you know, institutions of justice.
Yeah.
If a person doesn't have that experience. I mean, ultimately, if a person doesn't have any of these kinds of experiences, we call them sick, you know, pathological. We need to do everything we can in education, in parenting, in our churches and through art and music and literature and theater, to connect people, to help people have these experiences of the value, the preciousness of the story of the other. This is why literature is so critical, why good theater can really be very important for young people's lives to nurture this sense of justice.
Mm.
I'm teaching healthcare humanities right now, and we just spent a chapter on poetry related to experiences of illness and grief, because healthcare providers, people, my students who are training to be healthcare providers, they're not going to have all of these experiences of illness and suffering before they are a caregiver. But they can enter into that experience vicariously through good literature, through listening deeply to their patients, through this, again, we're going to go back to inquiry, asking the question, right? To create time to ask the question, what the person is feeling, what their story is, what their values are, what they hope for. And through these various ways, healthcare students of these various healthcare professions that are in this class can have a deeper sense, a deeper identification with pain, with suffering, with the kinds of experiences of illness. And they take that into the encounter with their patients.
Mm-hmm.
And it informs a more holistic kind of care.
Mm.
So that's just one example, right, mm-hmm. of all of the ways that we need to nurture the experience, the experience of the preciousness of the other, the experience of wonder, of awe, of gratitude, of deep appreciation.
Your poem, Early Path to the Edge, has hope as its subject. So I want to kind of move to hope here. At least I see it as hope as its subject. I'm wondering if you could read it for us.
Certainly. Early Path to the Edge. Before I make zucchini bread or do the laundry or scour the sink, an early path leads me to a rock on the water's edge, because this too is my calling, to find and feed this silence inside of comfort and inquiry. The wind is strong, waves clap a raucous rhythm. I focus on the promise of rising, the breaking day beyond the calendar or the alarm clock. Creased horizon hums with luminescence. The feathered breasts of the flying clouds are pink and pearl, hovering like ancient mother birds. When the sphere of lustrous radiance hoists itself out of the gray, roiling waves, I know I want to live for another day, even though I didn't have any doubt before its appearance. But I know again, there is an edge within me where doubt and dawn struggle and wonder wins and wins and wins.
Wonder wins and wins and wins. How do you maintain hope when we are surrounded, it seems sometimes, in injustice, darkness, a sense of powerlessness a lot of people feel? How do you maintain your hope?
I retain a sense of hope. Firstly, I think because I see immense courage in our human community. People who continue to resist oppression and work for the rights of all, even after they have experienced unbelievable trauma. I see people who are able to forgive and step into love, even though their lives have been torn apart. I see many young people with a sense of a deep urgency for change and the willingness to ask questions and listen to each other's story. And all of those kinds of things give me a great deal of hope.
Mm-hmm.
And they're innumerable.
Mm-hmm.
If you look, if you're attentive.
Yes. If you're attentive. Pay attention. Yeah. Thank you. Thank you for that. I'd like to encourage any of you who are viewing this evening, if you have any questions or comments, to send them in through the chat function as we continue. So I want to be sure, Gary, that we get to some practical wisdom from you. You've called the sense of wonder, the sense of awe, a posture. And I'm wondering if you could tell us some ways that you think that people could engage in, activities they can engage in, any kind of idea you have for us to learn to step into this posture, to really notice that purple iris or that red maple leaf that are shouting at me as I walk along that I so often miss.
Yeah, so this gets to the practice, right? To the,
yes.
the practice of being open to wonder, the practice of listening to stories, the practice of moving beyond our comfort zone.
Mm-hmm.
So there's so many different ways, right? I mean, in that little poem, Early Path to the Edge, I give you an example, right? Before you do the dishes or before you scour the sink, find a time, 2 minutes, or 20, find a place, a kind of sanctuary for yourself, and then be faithful to that practice. It's, I think, particularly important if you're able to find some natural connection. Maybe it's looking out a window at a tree. Maybe it's a park nearby. Maybe it's a path in the woods. Maybe it's a special spot that you go to along the shore once a week or once a month. But the important thing is a place and a time, and to be faithful to it. And to go there without expectation, just with an open heart, with open eyes. You might take along a journal and write about what you see and what you hear. So that's one kind of practice that I think is important. Another kind of practice is any kind of acquaintance or friendship or relationship that you can create across boundaries. Right? We all have boundaries, right? Maybe it's across social class. Maybe it's across disciplines. You know, it's somebody in the other part of the school. Maybe it's across lines of religion or race. Mm-hmm. But try to be intentional about creating a new acquaintance, having a conversation. And maybe it's just a conversation. Mm-hmm. You know, maybe the relationship doesn't go farther than that. But you've gone out of your usual group to have a conversation about something. Mm-hmm. And again, bring your natural inquiry, your genuine spirit of questioning, and try to get at each other's story. Mm. Right? That I think is a critically important practice, especially in our time when there's so much polarization, right? We tend to put each other in camps, and we're not camps. we're individual people with different kinds of ideas, and we need to really deeply listen to each other's story. Mm. Doesn't mean I necessarily agree with everything you say, for goodness sakes, no. But I still, I approach you with a sense of inquiry and reverence, because your life is precious. And it's only when we do that, that we create a deeper sense of connection and the opportunities for justice and equity thrive in that environment. They don't thrive in an environment where there's defensiveness, right? Where there's simply the other person shuts down because we've put them in a camp, we've called them a particular name, they've called us a particular name. Our perspective becomes one of fight or flight, right? rather than conversation,
right?
Rather than dialogue. This isn't necessarily easy, right? But we can train ourselves in all kinds of ways to be open to the other. I think it's as simple as, have you tried any new recipes lately? Have you read books that are different than the ones you usually read? Of different cultures, different kinds of experiences? No, have you gone to a piece of theater that's challenging?
Yeah.
All sorts of ways that we can kind of open ourselves up to seeing difference and connection through those differences.
Hmm. You know, Anne writes in a question that is very pertinent to this conversation. She says, what are we to do with the stories or perspectives of those whose perspective we find harmful or hurtful? How do we work alongside those people and their stories?
Yes, and this is a critical question, as were Barry's question and Paulette's question. These are wonderful, wonderful in-depth questions. This is one of the most difficult things, Anne, I think. How do we, again, remain open to the beauty and the preciousness and the value of that person and still recognize that some of that person's actions are harmful or maybe even hurtful to me or people whom I love?
Right.
This is the most difficult kind of thing. And yet, if we don't allow that conversation, right, then we have no opportunity for connecting with the person in terms of our stories. The only hope that we have for change, I think, is to understand how important something is to another person. That might facilitate change. Mm. So this is a very, very difficult thing.
Yeah.
I do think that whenever possible, we should try to find things that we do have in common, even though we know that we have major differences, and they're differences that are very difficult. I think still there's the possibility that we can find something in common that we could work together on, that we could agree on, that we could share with each other.
Mm-hmm.
And that begins, I think, to change both of us in terms of a deeper commitment to the whole, to the common good.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Common thirst and common life. Well, I'm conscious of our time here, and this hour has flown by with you, Gary. It's been just beautiful, beautiful conversation. I want to thank everyone for being here with us tonight and ask you to mark your calendars for next month's Benedictine Conversation, which will be on November 23rd. Details will be coming out very soon in emails about that next Benedictine Conversation, part of this same series. And then Gary, this has been beautiful, and I just really want to thank you for this time here with us tonight, and to just ask you if there's anything you want to leave us with, any words you want to leave us with.
About one last poem.
Yes, yes.
This is a poem that uses a concept of many indigenous peoples in their prayers say all my relations. And when they say that, they mean everybody, right? All of the four-legged ones and the winged ones and the slithering ones and the two-legged ones, all my relations. But the sole of the foot steps softly to meet the world. Let the face tilt upward and open toward the sun. Let the arms stretch out in the ancient gesture of all winged things. Let the hands cup the flowing air as a deep swimmer in the ocean of all things possible. Let us say together, in the one language of breath, all my relations. Let us step quietly over the boundaries we have created to divide us, the imaginary boundaries on our maps, lot lines and plot lines and zoning codes. Let us choose to forget the long litany of exclusion, nations, states, colors, genders, tribes, species, and let us say together in the one language of breath, all my relations. Thank you for this wonderful time together.
Beautiful, thank you. And on behalf of the Sisters of St. Scholastica and the Center for Spirituality and Enrichment, to everyone with us tonight, blessings of beauty, peace, and hope to you and your loved ones. Thank you, Gary. Thank you, everyone. Thank you. Good night.